अथ नित्यो नारायण ब्रह्मा नारायण शिवश्च नारायण एंड स्वामी। नाउ द उपनिषद इज डिस्क्राइबिंग दैट नारायण इज एवरीथिंग, सर्वात्मत्व ऑफ नारायण। अथ नित्य नारायण, नारायण द सुप्रीम लॉर्ड इज इटर्नल। We have the clay and the various objects produced out of clay. Chandogya Upanishad says, Vacharambhanam vikaro namadheyam mrittikeyeva satyam. Whether you call it as a pot or a plate or a broken pot shell, they are all different names, different forms, no doubt. But the original substance which has appeared through these various objects is one and the same, that is clay. Whatever may be the karya, the different forms of the effects or products, the original karana cause is the same. Since the whole universe has come out of Lord Narayana, since this universe is ever changing, constantly changing, we have to come to the conclusion that Narayana, who is the original cause, the basic cause of the whole universe, he is eternal. Worlds may come and go. After creation, even in the particular world, things may change, but what has manifested itself as or in and through this universe is Narayana, the Supreme Lord. There is absolutely no change in him. He is eternal. And the karyas or effects, products, may be many. You take, for instance, a seed. Once the seed is planted in the ground and taken care of properly, it gradually grows into a mighty tree. We look at the tree. The tree has its roots, it has its trunk, it has the various branches, it has its leaves, and then there are fruits, and even inside the fruit, inside the leaf, inside the branch, there are any number of differences. But the seed is responsible for the whole tree, and in effect we can say the seed is there in every one of these manifestations. So like that, the whole universe has been created or has been manifested out of Brahman, the Supreme Spirit called Narayana here. Therefore, in spite of the fact that all these objects of creation appear to be different from one another, the basic substance behind them, the basic cause or the root behind them is Narayana. He alone is Nitya. Everything else is Anitya, transient, changing. Brahma, Shiva and Chakra, they are also Narayana. Once the universe is created, the Lord has created any number of other things also as part and parcel of the system of creation. There is Brahma, Chaturmukha Brahma, who starts the process of creation as per the directions given to him by Narayana. Then there is Shiva, the Samharakarta. At the end of a cycle of creation, the world is withdrawn, upasamhara, involution of the world back into the original cause. And Shiva, Rudra, is the deity assigned the task of upasamhara or destruction or dissolution of this universe. He is also Narayana. Then there is Chakra. Chakra is Indra, Devaraja. And God created the universe. He created the 14 worlds, or 3 worlds, Svargaloka, Martyaloka and Pataloka. And Svargaloka is ruled by Chakra or Indra, who is called as Devaraja. He is the king of all the various gods that inhabit heaven. And he is also Narayana, not different from Narayana. So Brahma, Shiva and Chakra, these three represent the entire creation of living beings, Chetana Jagat. It's not necessary for the Upanishad, for the text, to mention every detail in creation. Some important things are mentioned, and then you say, etc. This is something like that. Brahma, Shiva and Chakra, or Indra, they are created by Lord Narayana, or they are born out of, manifested out of Narayana, and they exist as long as the universe exists, and they are in essence Narayana himself. Since all the three are sentient deities, deities with Chaitanya, with consciousness, we can extend the principle to all other living beings in the universe, including the various worlds above and below this earth, to be represented by these. And all of them, the entire Chetana Jagat, is ultimately Narayana himself. Then Dishascha Narayanaha, Kalascha Narayanaha. Kala is time, Dik is space. So space and time, which are very important in this universe, which are part and parcel of this created universe, they are also Narayana. There is nothing in this created world which is different from the Supreme God called Narayana here in this Upanishad. We can extend this again, since Kala and Desha, or Dik, space and time, are Achetana Vastus, they have no life, no consciousness. We can extend it to all the insentient objects in this universe. Whatever exists in this universe, whether it is with life or without life, Sthavara Jangama, all these things are ultimately Narayana himself. And this Narayana is Urdhvascha Narayana, Adhascha Narayana. It's a beautiful description that Narayana is everywhere. Then, the essential characteristics of Narayana are described in the next two or three lines. His Narayana is Nishkala. Nishkalaha, Niranjanaha, Nirvikalpaha, Nirakhyataha, Shuddhaha, Devaha, Eko Narayanaha. Kala means part. So Nishkalaha means one who is without parts. So this is one of the important arguments given by Bhagavan Shankara to prove that Brahman is partless. Any object that has got parts, which is created by the bringing together of the various parts, assembling the various parts, is going to be destroyed one day. What is made up of parts can also disintegrate in course of time. So if you accept that Brahman, the Supreme Lord, has avayavas or limbs within himself, then we have to conclude that even this Brahman is anitya. What is an assemblage can in course of time become disintegrated. So to eliminate this particular argument against Lord Narayana Sar Parabrahma supremacy, the Upanishad is telling, he is Nishkalaha. There are no avayavas or limbs. He is without limbs, without parts. He is a homogeneous whole. Well, according to Advaita, whatever we see here as the created universe is not real. It is only an adhyasa, an appearance in the substratum called Brahman. The famous examples given in Advaita Vedanta are Rajju Sarpanyaya. You see a snake in a rope in insufficient light, or you see silver in nacre. But it is a misreading of the substance. What is not there, you are seeing that. What it is, you are not able to see. So according to this standpoint, Advaitic standpoint, Narayana has no parts at all. Then how do you explain this universe? It is a maya, it is an adhyasa, it is illusion, it is appearance. But the other two systems of Vedanta, Vishishta Dvaita and Dvaita, do not accept this argument. They concede that this world is very, very real. It is as real as Lord Narayana himself or God himself. Ramanuja says in one place, your arguments which pertain to this world, here and now, they do not apply there. Human logic does not apply to things which are spiritual, eternal. So, though in general, any object which is made up of parts is going to disintegrate and Brahman is without parts, even though we accept it, in according to Dvaita Vedanta, in the Dvaita systems, even if Brahman transforms himself into this universe, he is not going to be destroyed. It is called Brahma Parinamavada. Just as milk becoming curds, the Lord can become the universe and still transcend it. A part of the Supreme Lord has become the universe. He lives inside it. He also transcends it. So he is Nishkalaha, without parts. Then he is Niranjanaha. Anjana means stain. He is stainless. How does a living being get these stains? We have a body, we have the sense organs, we have the mind. All these are products of the three gunas. Trigunatmika, Maya or Avidya. And Rajas and Tamas practically form the impurity. So, as long as we have a body and indriyas and mind, as long as we are associated with that and get identified with that, we have got to concede that we are not very pure. But as far as Brahman is concerned, Narayana is concerned, he is beyond the three gunas. He is mayatita, gunatita. Therefore, he is Niranjana. No stain can ever stick to him. He is also called as Nirvikalpa. Vikalpa means varieties. Nirvikalpa, he has no varieties. He is one homogeneous whole. There is no vaividhya in him because he is pure consciousness. Niranjana Nirvikalpa. Then he is Nirakhyata. He can never be described through words. Sri Ramakrishna used to say that Brahman and Brahman alone has not become Uchishta in this world. Whatever touches the tongue and comes out is Uchishta. It is spoiled. But Brahman is something which has never been described by the human tongue. Therefore, it has not become Uchishta. Yato vacho nivartante apraptya manasasaha. This is how Taittiriya Upanishad puts it. Avang manasagocharam, something which is beyond speech and beyond mind. This point has been described any number of times in the previous talks. The entire system of words, language, is tailored to suit the Panchendriya experiences. God, who is beyond the ken of the sense organs, can never be described through these words. Mukaswadanavat, one of the sutras from Narada Sutras. It says, like a dumb person who is eating a sweet but who cannot describe his enjoyment, inner enjoyment, like that Brahman can be experienced but cannot be expressed. Then he is called as Deva, Shuddhaha. He is Nishkalanka and Niranjana. Therefore he has got to be Shuddha. He has no stain in him. He has no parts. He is homogeneous. He is complete. He is whole. He is full. He is absolutely pure. So Nishkalanka and Niranjana, these two words describe Lord Narayana in the negative way. Shuddhaha is describing him in the positive way. Absolutely pure, unmixed with anything else. And he is Devaha. Eko Deva. Div is the root word and it can mean two or three things. One is light. So he is brilliant. He is all light because he is Chaitanya, all knowledge. Secondly, Div means to play. The Lord plays as it were with this universe. Lokavattu Lila Kaivalyam, as Brahma Sutras put it, creation is like a play for the Supreme Lord. He shines, so he is called as Deva. He plays with the universe as it were, therefore he is called as Deva. Ekaha na dvitiyaha asti kashchit. He is one and one alone, without anything else second to him. There is nothing which is different from him. There is nothing which is equal to him. There is nothing which can in any way even approach him. Ekameva dvitiyam brahma. Shvetashvatara Upanishad is just outside the list of 10. There is a nice commentary on the Upanishad by Shankara, though people may or may not agree. It's in a very nice commentary. The Upanishad begins with a very interesting dialogue. A number of rishis have joined together, have gathered together. They are putting the question, Kim Karanam Brahma Kutasma Jata, and so on. What is the ultimate cause of this universe? Where from did we come? To where do we go back? And so on. They went on discussing and discussing. Any number of theories were put forward, but these theories did not satisfy them. Finally, they retired into meditation, and in the depths of their meditation, they found out the ultimate truth, Devatma Shaktim Swagunair Nigudham. This Upanishad describes the nature of Brahman in number of shlokas. Eko Devaha Sarvabhuteshu Gudhaha. The Supreme Lord is one and he is hidden in the hearts of all the living beings. Sakshi Cheta Kevalo Nirgunascha. He is consciousness itself. He is the witness of the whole universe. He is the witness of all that is taking place within us. He is Kevala, one without a second. And he is Nirguna, beyond the three gunas, Sattva, Rajas and Tamas. Or he doesn't have any particular qualities with the help of which you can describe him. We try to describe a person, he is 6 feet tall, he is probably 78 kgs in weight, and he is dark in color, and so on and so forth. None of these descriptions is possible in the case of the Supreme Lord. Natasya kaschit patirasti loke. There is no one in this universe who is his Lord. He is the Supreme Lord. There is none who can rule over him. Na tat samascha abhyadhikascha drishyate. There is none who is equal to him or superior to him. Natasya pratima asti. There is no second object which is like him. Pratima, an image. There is not even an image of the Supreme Lord. All these adjectives are used by the Upanishads to show that Brahman or the Supreme Lord alone is the truth. He alone existed before creation, after creation also, during creation also. Sadeva somyedamagra asit ekamivadvitiyam. Shetaketu is being taught by his father Gautama Aruni. In the beginning, Sat Eva, only the Sat Vastu, the reality alone existed, the one without a second. And then that will let me become many, and it manifested itself as this universe. Generally in this world we find the relationship, Karya Karana Bhava, cause and effect relationship is there. I find an object and then try to argue backwards. This is a piece of, it's a paperweight, it's made of stone. The stone must have something else behind it. So we can go on arguing from effect to the cause, from the cause to its cause and so on. But somewhere we have to stop. Otherwise, as the saying goes, it becomes redundant. Vriksha bija nyaya. It goes on like that. Since this type of arguing backwards is not going to help us, we have to accept at a particular point there is one original cause which is eternal, from which everything else has come. And that original cause, the karana of all the karanas, is Supreme Brahman or God. Today the modern scientists are also gradually coming round to see perhaps there is a fundamental substance behind this universe. Yaha evam veda saha vishnureva bhavati. One who knows this, one who knows thus, he verily becomes Vishnu. Yajurveda shirah pratipadya narayana yathatmyam veda saha vidvan Vishnuhu Narayanaha Nishpratiyogika Paramatma Eva Bhakti. So the Upanishad is telling us, after describing the various characteristics of Lord Narayana, one who knows this, one who knows thus, one who knows Lord Narayana, one who knows the Supreme Lord as endowed with all these qualities, what will happen to him, what will become of him? Saha Vishnureva Bhavati. He verily becomes Vishnu. Vishnu means the all-pervading reality. Vishnu also means Narayana. He becomes identified with the Supreme Lord. According to Advaita Vedanta, as soon as we realize the Atman, we automatically realize the Brahman and we become one with it. Jnana samakala deliye Paramatmanali layavakteve, Paramatmani navakteve. That is the Advaitic standpoint. But in the Bhakti Vedanta schools, which believe that the Jivatman and Paramatman are eternally different from one another, they interpret the sentence in a different way. He becomes Vishnu means he becomes like Vishnu. Sarupya, the four kinds of mukti or liberation are mentioned in the Bhakti scriptures. One is called Sarukya. He gets a form which is similar to that of the Lord. Then Salokya, living in the same world as the Lord. Samipya, living near him and serving him. And Sarashtya, getting the same experience or the powers that the Lord has. Whatever it is, we can say that one who meditates upon God, one who realizes God, ultimately becomes one with him. Upasaka becomes identified with Upasya Devata. Savishnureva Bhavati, Savishnureva Bhavati. It is repeated two times. It is called Dvirabhyasa, Dvirabhyasa or Dvirupti. And in the scriptures, whenever a particular word or sentence is repeated two times or three times, it may mean that the particular topic comes to a close, or it may mean that the Upanishad or the scripture is trying to extol that particular object or particular subject. Viruktihi adarartha. In order to produce that faith, love, devotion in our minds towards this knowledge, the Upanishad is repeating it. Even in our day-to-day life, if you want to emphasize something, we tell the person two times or three times, both in the positive and in the negative ways.